A palindrome is a string that reads the same from left to right as it does from right to left. So, for example, if we ignore spaces and punctuation, then a man, a plan, a canal, Panama is a palindrome. It reads the same from left to right as it does from right to left. The sequence of characters is exactly the same. We can also think about palindromes when we talk about bit strings. In this case, a sequence of zeros and ones should be the same whether you read the bit string from left to right or from right to left. Now, we can design a Turing machine that detects whether an input, of, like in a bit string, is a palindrome or not. And this Turing machine will run for order of n squared many steps for an n-bit input. The question is whether we can do better than that. So can you design a Turing machine that is better than quadratic in its running time to detect whether an input is a palindrome or not? The answer to this question is no. We can actually prove a lower bound that says it's necessary for a normal Turing machine to run for this many steps to solve this problem in general. There are direct proofs of this statement, but we can also use communication complexity tools to prove this. And this might be surprising at first, because as you can see, there's no obvious communication happening here. This has nothing to do with communication on the face of it, but we can turn it into a communication type problem and then use our tools from communication complexity to show that it's not possible for a Turing machine to decide this problem in less than quadratic time. Essentially, we will do the following. Assume for contradiction that there exists a Turing machine that can solve this palindrome problem more efficiently. Then we will argue that we can construct a communication protocol for the equality function that uses fewer than n bits. Here's how we do this. Take the Turing machine that solves the palindrome problem. And we look at the input on the tape, which are these n bits. We now split this tape into three parts, three separate parts. The first third, so the first n over 3 many bits, the middle part, the middle n over 3 bits, and then the last part, the last n over 3 many bits. I want to focus on the middle section. Suppose there is a cell in the middle section that our Turing machine only leaves with the tape head at most k times. Then I claim I can construct a communication protocol for equality that only uses order of k many bits of communication. And here's how you would do this. We would write our inputs for Alice and Bob onto the tape in the following way. So Alice has input x, and we would write this in the first part of the tape, so in the first n over 3 cells. So the first cell gets x1, the second cell gets second bit x2, and so on. And then the input for Bob we write into the last third of this tape that we are looking at, and we do this in reverse order. So we write y1 in the very last cell of the segment of the tape, and we write y2 just to the left of that, and y3 just to the left of that, and so on. And in the middle part of this segment, we just write zeros on the tape. So this is our input. And as you can see, this input will be a palindrome if and only if x is equal to y, right? So only if x1 is equal to y1 and x2 is equal to y2 and so on, will this be a palindrome. So therefore, by deciding whether this particular input is a palindrome or not, we're actually also deciding whether x is equal to y or not. Now, Alice and Bob will be able to work together to simulate this Turing machine that detects palindromes. And to do this, Alice will be responsible for the part of the tape from the very left end of the tape until cell I, which is the cell that we said the Turing machine only leaves K many times with the head. And Bob will be responsible for the rest of the tape, so everything from I to the right of this. As long as the tape head is in the first section, so at cell I or before, Alice will just simulate the Turing machine. So she will keep track of what's written on the tape there. She will keep track of how the head moves, what the transition function says, what characters need to be written on the tape, and so on. And so she will just keep track of all of this and simulate everything. The only thing that's interesting here is that if the head of the Turing machine moves over to Bob's part of the tape, so if the head of the Turing machine moves from cell I to cell I plus 1, in which case Alice doesn't know how to continue the simulation because the head is now in a position on the tape that she is not responsible for and where she doesn't necessarily know what even the contents of the tape is anymore. So the cells from I plus 1 to the right, Alice doesn't know what's written in those cells. So if this happens and the head of the Turing machine moves from cell I to cell I plus 1, so we cross this boundary, then Alice has to pass on this simulation of the Turing machine to Bob. And she needs to tell Bob about everything he needs to know to correctly continue the simulation. So what information does Bob need? Bob knows what's written on the cells on the tape in cells I plus 1 and to the right of that. So Alice doesn't need to tell him, and in fact she couldn't because she doesn't even know herself. But what Bob needs to know is what the internal state of the Turing machine is. So this is what Bob really needs to know. So Alice will tell Bob, okay, I'm done with my simulation in my part. The head is moving over to your part. It's now in cell I plus 1. I don't know how to continue. You have to continue for me. And by the way, the internal state of the Turing machine is, say, Q. And then Bob says, okay, fine. I know the internal state of the Turing machine is Q, and I know what's written in my cells on my side, and he can just continue the simulation of the Turing machine perfectly fine, just up to the point where the head moves back into Alice's part. So at some point it might be happening that the head of the Turing machine is in cell I plus 1, and the transition function says the head should move to the left, in which case it would move over this boundary into Alice's part, and then Bob just hands the simulation back to Alice. And Bob will tell Alice, okay, I'm done here, you have to continue the simulation, and by the way, the internal state of the Turing machine now is Q prime. And then Alice can continue, and they keep doing this. In this way, they will be able to decide this palindrome question, and therefore will be able to decide whether x is equal to y or not. The only remaining question is, how many bits did they communicate to one another? Each time they hand over the simulation, they only need to tell the other party what state the Turing machine is in. The Turing machine has a fixed number of internal states, and because this is fixed and independent of the size of the input, this only requires a constant number of bits to communicate. So each time this happens, they need to communicate a constant number of bits. The second question is, how often does this happen? But we said that we're only leaving this cell I at most k times, and so we're only moving over this threshold at most order k many times. And each of those times we need a constant number of bits of communication. So the total communication we are using is in the order of k. Therefore, we now have a communication protocol that solves equality using O of k bits of communication. However, we have also learned that equality requires at least order of n many bits of communication, and therefore k has to be at least order of n. And therefore, we know that in this middle section of the tape, the Turing machine head leaves each of those cells at least order of n many times. And there are n over 3 many of those cells. So in total, we know that there are cells there that have to be left at least n squared, order of n squared many times. So this is a lower bound for the number of steps the Turing machine has to make. There must be at least order of n squared steps where the head moves in this middle section of the tape somehow. This concludes the proof. As you can see, you can use communication complexity tools sometimes in situations where it's not obvious that there's any communication involved at all. In this example, we artificially saw the data we have as having different parts. There was like a left part and a right part. And we imagined that to solve our problem, those different parts of the data have to communicate somehow. There needs to be some exchange of information between those different parts. And that is what we can reason about. So communication complexity is useful even in situations where there is no obvious communication. That's the take-home message here. It's often just another way of thinking about computation.